What's up guys, it's Justin here, and today I'm here to bring you guys my full overview of the just announced iPhone 5S. As you know, Apple did take the stage earlier today to show us the new iPhone 5S, and there are a few things that are not really major changes, and there are a few things that I'm actually personally very excited about. So starting out with the color, it seemed like lately a lot of people have been talking about the color. A gold or champagne iPhone 5S is a reality. In my opinion, I think it does look pretty cool. It is still going to be available in a white and silver, but one thing that has changed is that the black model has been replaced by a space gray, like they like to call it. And I think that is kind of because the black slate model did have some issues with the chipping. I also saw some people have their black kind of fade off of their phone, but I'm actually pretty curious to see how the gray actually looks. It actually looks pretty nice in the photos that Apple did release. It will still be coming in a 16, 32, and 64 gigabyte configuration, starting at $199 on a two-year contract. Same price and everything as the previous model. The overall form factor does look the same as well. But I'm actually really excited about the internals. It is an Apple A7 processor like we had predicted, a 64-bit, which is the first seen on a smartphone. It's gonna be a very powerful processor. I'm very excited to check that out, and they do claim that it is 5 times faster than the iPhone 5. That's gonna bring some extra power whether you're doing gaming, and your everyday tasks are just gonna run so much better from that processor. And there's also a coprocessor that they like to call the M7 Motion coprocessor that enhances fitness apps. So it is made just for motion. You know, Nike does have an app that is able to track your daily activity. So they want to kind of encourage that, more people to start using those, and more developers can create apps and take advantage of the M7 coprocessor. The next thing is that the display has stayed the same, a 4-inch Retina display, 1136 by 640 resolution. Nothing has really changed there. We didn't really expect it to have a larger screen until next year, the iPhone 6. But in the camera itself, I was a little bit surprised. It does stay at 8 megapixels. I did think that they would actually improve it to a 10, a 12, or even a 13 megapixel camera. We did see an increase from the 4 to the 4S. But I guess the camera on the iPhone 5 is already very good, but they did do quite a few things to make it a little bit better. It does have a continuous burst, True Tone flash, a dual flash I think it looks like, auto image stabilization so you can capture your quick images better, it'll automatically stabilize it and get a nice focused, crisp image, slow motion video, and also live zoom during video, so you could still pinch zoom. Of course it's digital zoom, but I guess when it's handy you can use that. And slow motion video, I guess some people would like to use that if you're doing any skateboarding tricks. I think it's actually pretty cool with all the settings they've done. And of course, iOS 7 and the redesigned camera app has made it very handy and take advantage of all the new features. I also really like the square photo built into iOS 7 for a lot of people who take Instagram images. And the FaceTime HD camera is 1.9 megapixels. And they have also made the pixels itself 15% larger. It is now a 1.5 microns sensor. So that'll get you a little bit better image quality like they claim. And it has an aperture of f2.2, which is still gonna get you some great depth of field. So in terms of the camera, we're really gonna have to see if there's an improvement. Of course, I'll do a comparison when it arrives. But in terms of the megapixels itself, it hasn't really changed yet. Of course, it will ship with iOS 7. There's also LTE wireless. And one thing I wish they had done, but they actually didn't, is it doesn't have any 802.11ac support, which is the next generation wireless, which I really don't understand, as Apple did release a AirPort Extreme that did have AC support, so it makes it kind of weird that their next generation smartphone, the flagship phone, doesn't have support for AC and the faster speeds for that. So I think that's one thing that I was a little bit disappointed about. Of course, there's also the fingerprint sensor. There was a lot of talk about that before that, and I actually wasn't really understanding why they would need a fingerprint sensor in the phone itself. However, the fingerprint sensor is going to be built into the home button. You can also see a little bit of a ring or a halo built into the phone as well around the home button. I think that adds a little bit of a design accent and one noticeable change when you put it side by side to the iPhone 5. The fingerprint sensor will be used for stuff like unlocking your phone, being able to enter your password without actually having to type it in. You're able to have multiple on the account. So this is the first time we've really seen any large phone company kind of push out this kind of technology. So we're really gonna have to see which direction this goes, whether people will be using it or not. There's also some Apple design cases that they introduced that will be selling for $39, a little bit steep for a case, but I guess I'll check it out. But pretty much other than that, in terms of the software, Apple did also offer their apps like Pages, Keynote, iMovie, iPhoto for free, allowing you to use the phone and take advantage of it for productivity. As you know, previously you did have to pay for that, but that is now going to be free. So thanks for watching. Be sure to hit that like button if you enjoyed my video. Thanks for watching again, and be sure to subscribe for some day one overview coverage, comparisons like you've seen me do, and I'll see you all in the next video.